Wow. Now, isn't that just the most beautiful thing you've ever laid your eyes upon? It's breathtaking, absolutely beautiful. You might be thinking, you know, your wife, your girlfriend, nah, you might want to reconsider, because this stuff sparkles. Look at it sparkle. I got a bunch of redstone. We might need it today. So, I went caving for a bit, got tons of redstone, iron, all the good stuff that we need all the time. And we are going to probably enchant something once I finish. Yes. I'm using fortune, right? Yeah. Just gotta double check, because I would be very sad if I was using my other pick. Yeah, we'll probably get to level 30 easy from this. We will enchant a sword, I think. Yeah, didn't quite finish getting all the redstone, but we did get 30. Boop, boop. Boop, boop. So, I keep trying to get Unbreaking 3 on my swords now that it's possible. I want to see it again. I did it once. Unbreaking 3, looting 3, come on. Whoa! Sharpness 4, Unbreaking 3, Knockback 2, Fire Aspect 2. Enchanting swords has got a lot more fun. Oh, they don't stand a chance. Got Fire Aspect, no? What? Fire Aspect. Look, I've used it that many times and it still hasn't taken any durability off of it. Oh, there we go. First one. That is pretty cool. Unbreaking is very nice. We use 2 durability out of all those swings. Why is it not setting mobs on fire, though? Huh. And even when it doesn't kill them. Anyway, whatever. No big deal. I actually don't really like Fire Aspect anymore now that zombies can set you on fire. It's actually very dangerous sometimes when you use it. But I've been working on something I've been wanting to do for a long time, everybody. And it's finally done. Woohoo! The map has been complete. Oh, it looks so much better than what we had there before, doesn't it? Like with all the unconnected item frames that were empty. And now we have a nice, beautiful map. Can't really see a whole lot from it from a distance, except for maybe the basic terrain. As I was doing this, it was actually kind of sad because, you know, it wasn't surprising, but a lot of the stuff I've built is underground and you can't actually see it on the map, so there's not a lot to see from it. But it's kind of encouraged me, maybe we should start building on the surface a bit more. In fact, as I was running around mapping out my world here, I saw a lot of very nice areas, especially around these mountains. This area here is very nice, so we might want to start building there sometime soon in the future. But I'll take you through some of the terrain and stuff, some of the features of our world. Maybe we will expand this. I didn't pick the best spot for this, actually. We might set up more maps in other places. These aren't too bad on your computer anymore, because Dinnerbone has it, so it only renders the map, I think, when it loads now, instead of like every frame like it was doing before. So it's a lot easier on your computer, but we are right there. You can see my little wooden bridge over here that goes over top the river. This is my man-made river that goes all the way down here. We got the trees on the sides that are all lit up. It also splits off this way. This is that fake overhang, fake terrain I built over top that the river goes underneath. We got the snowflake over there. This is the ravine that I first saw in the world, close to spawn. That's the glowing tree up there on the snow-covered mountain now. That's the giant reed farm over here. The jungle trees with the hanging glowstone is over there. That's also where my sand pit is. I covered that all up, try and make it look nicer. This is the cyan clay road, lined with leaves, that goes up towards the library, which is up over here. And you see it's all flattened out. And yeah, we gotta build that still. Let's see what else. This little thing is the spawn platform right up in the sky. And little sheep farm over here. This is the lake, the firework lake over here with the You've Been Ethoed sign there. There's a desert up this way, which I didn't really know about. I usually don't go up this way because it's mostly water. But yeah, if we go a little further, there's a desert. And let's see. Down this way is towards the stronghold base. If we go down, it's actually about 800 blocks from here. If you go straight down. And apparently, this is within range on the map. This is my new pit for getting sand, where I've been moving the silverfish, and where we fight the withers usually. It's over there. Pretty much all this section here to the right is mountains, and you can see some places where the snow's fallen already. This is probably where we're going to be expanding in the future. If we want to build on the surface, let's go this way, because around here is a very nice area, and we might want to try extend the water, like try make rivers that go out that way. If we take out the land here, there's just little land pieces connecting or preventing the water from connecting all the way through. Or we could go over top and do the same pretty much and make it go down maybe. And yeah, there's a snow biome there. I think up to the left here is a jungle biome, if I remember right. And yeah, so that's our world. This part of it, there's actually quite a bit around the stronghold base too that we can't see on here, like the village and all that. But nice little overview of our world anyway. I'll give you a quick overview of the world too from on top of this tree. You can see a lot of the things I pointed out. Give you a better idea, help you visualize where things are. So that's the water that way, mountains that way, stronghold is that way, and not much is back that way. But yeah, what do you guys think of the new rendering code in the snapshot? Personally, I find it makes everything look pretty good, like especially stuff in the background, except for maybe leaves. I don't like the way leaves look very much. And I've tried changing the settings. You can't get them to look the way they used to, I don't think. Like, not too sure what is. It's like they're more transparent now. You can really see the birchwood through those trees, for example. It really stands out. And then when there's a big clump of leaves, like in pretty much all these trees, it looks like they're solid blocks. Like, they're very non-transparent. So it's like, it's like they're really transparent, but they're not. They're really untransparent, non-transparent, whatever. So I don't know. Maybe they'll change the leaves up a bit, but everything else I think looks pretty good. Different axe. So the plan for today, guys. You don't often see this. I'm chopping down trees right now, and I actually do a lot of things in my world that take a bit of time that you don't really see, like chopping trees, collecting sand, collecting clay, collecting quartz, going caving, and something we touched on last episode that we're going to maybe work on a bit more today, except in a different way, is moving items around and just general transport, and that in my world takes quite a bit of time. Yeah, I don't mind if that breaks. So I had this idea today. It's a little complicated. Might not work perfectly, but we will see. I did mess with it in creative already, and I think I got it to work. Actually spent like, I spent 2 or 3 hours, oh, there it goes, trying to get this idea to work, like just the basics of it, and I finally figured out a way to do it. It was actually kind of frustrating, because it used to work, no problem, and now it's like, game mechanics have changed and I had a lot of trouble with it. But the idea is we're going to try build a portal network. Almost like the internet in my world. I don't know. It's I want to try link all the portals together in a certain way. Not the overworld portals, like the ones in this world, just the nether ones I want connected together and to interact with each other in different ways. And if it works out the way I'm planning, we will be able to move myself, items, like if I want to move several stacks of ender pearls, or even moving animals like silverfish or anything in my world, I'll be able to move everything within like a 2,000 by 2,000 area to another part of my world within 30 seconds or less, I think, if this idea works out the way I'm planning, which could be pretty cool, but we'll see how it goes. And it's going to take a little while to set up for all the portals. But let's get to it. I'm going to hop over to the nether, and we'll try to rig up one of the portals the way it needs to be for the stronghold base first off. All right, so the stronghold portal was over here before. I'm moving it right now, just in case this becomes a more permanent thing. I want it in a better spot. And I want to try to make a 3x3. I think it looks cooler. I like odd numbers a lot more than even numbers in this game. That should work. Good. And stronghold. Oh. Okay, yeah, we're here. Good. And will we go back? Yes, we will. Awesome. I think as we work here, I'm going to just disable this one so we don't hear it the whole time. The idea is actually really simple, and I can demonstrate it real quick here. I'm sure you're familiar with it. Let's pretend soil blocks are nether portals, like this one here. So if you have a nether portal, and we'll use stone bricks for an overworld portal. So those two are linked together. And they're in the correct position in the overworld and the nether, right? Now, if you build another overworld portal, like 1,000 blocks away, and you go in this one, it's going to take you to the nether portal all the way over here. And then when you go through this nether portal again, it takes you to that one. So when you go through an overworld portal, it checks 128 block radius in the nether for a nether portal. So that 1024 divided by 8 is 128 blocks. And if there is one in that range, it will link to that. But then when it goes back to the overworld, it checks for the nearest one within, I think, 256 blocks radius. So it's only going to check like up to here, and of course since there's one right where it's supposed to be, it's going to link up with that one, right? So you can use that to get quick transport like a long distance, because you go into the nether and then you go back to the overworld. You've moved 1,000 blocks just by going through two portals, which is pretty cool. The thing is, you can't get back there, right? You can't. You have to walk it, right? So that's why people set up several, like multiple portals in the nether, right? So if you put the nether portal, another one, linked up properly with this one, if you go through this one, you go to that one. Then you can walk in the nether, it's only 128 blocks or so, and then go to that one. And then when you go through that, you go back down, and you go there, and so forth. But you don't go from there to there anymore, or from there to there. Unless you do what I'm trying to do, and that is enable and disable the nether portals so that, for example, even though we still have the nether portals set up, I want to disable them so I can go from, like, from there to there, you know, and send items or animals through the portal, go to there, then I can send them through again, and they'll end up here, you know. And I can do that with many, many portals if I set it up right. Which is what we're attempting to do right now. Maybe I'll, actually, you know an easy way of disabling a portal? There we go. Much quieter. So, let's begin. This is how we are going to do it. See if I can remember how to build this. So, dispensers. This one's going to have flint and steel in. If you have flint and steel in, you can light the portal with that, no problem. And obviously, we will put that in there. So we gotta send two pulses to that. It'll pick up the lava and it'll break the portal. And that's how we're gonna enable and disable the portals. Flint and steel and lava bucket. Pretty simple. We'll get a button. Maybe we'll just put the button down here. And do that. So now when you press a button, it'll light the portal. And we want it to go... Let's see. Let's take out some of this. Let's set up the lava bucket thing. So that's a little more complicated, but there is an easy way to do it. If we... see. I think get a sticky piston, a block, and send a repeater through it like that. So when that goes, it'll activate it once, and now to get it to activate again, we will also split the signal. Go this way, we gotta set it to 2 to give it enough time. And go to a block like that. And that, so it'll go into the dispenser, then it does 2 ticks, goes to that dust, and back to the dispenser, and it'll click it again. 2 clicks, very good. And all we need to do now is connect this button to, I think, 10 or 11 repeaters. It's got to have 41 ticks, so I'll set that up. Oh, you can tell I've been here for a little while. We got tons and tons of gas out there, but I think I got it working now. So yeah, if we go around, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6... 7, 8, 9, 10, 11 repeaters. All of these are set to 4 except for this one. It's set at 1. So that's 41 redstone ticks total. And I also set up 2 more buttons here. This is just a manual enable for the portal. This bottom one, it goes right to that dispenser. Like so. And the top one is a manual disable, which goes right to the disable mechanism up there. Nice and simple. So this is for the timer. Takes 4 seconds to go through the portal, and then it disables it. So this is what gave me all the trouble, though, because in the past, let's say we had an 8-second timer on this thing, 8-second redstone timer. You could go in within the first 4 seconds, and then the redstone would continue after you went through for another 4 seconds and disable it all on its own, no problem. Not anymore. In the game, when you go through a portal and you leave the nether, the redstone stops. It actually stops where it's at and remembers next time you load up the chunks. Unless you got some special chunk loading setup going on, it will not disable the portal. So, I had to figure out how to make it do that, and I came up with a bit of a cheaty way. So, it takes us 40 ticks to go through, and then there's 1 tick left. Let's hope this works. You heard the piston go right as we went in there. So now, I'm going to drink this just in case we have trouble. I can't remember if this was still a problem. We go through. Oh, did it actually work? What the heck? usually I have to do something else to make it work, but that just worked on its own. That's interesting. Okay. Is that a good thing or a bad thing? I kind of liked it the way it was before. Let's try one more time. Maybe there's mobs here that are keeping it loaded or something. Okay, and we go back through. Oh, unless... Yeah, this was taking us to that portal before, right? Huh. Anyway, I guess that works. So, if we go through this one, we got teleported a little bit of ways in the nether here. Because this takes us to the village now. Instead of to the stronghold. So that is the general idea behind it. The real complicated part to all of this now is what I would like to do is set up like a destination selector outside of each of these portals. So have like a wall of buttons and let's say go to stronghold, hit the button, and then that needs to disable all the nether portals except for the stronghold one. It needs to turn that one on, which is not by us. It might have to send a redstone signal like 100 blocks or more to turn that portal on, and then we would go through here on the timer, and then when we go back out, we should end up at the stronghold. So we have to set up like a redstone network now to enable and disable the portals properly. But first, we should set up a few more of these, which I'll do off-camera, because we only have one right now. We can't make a network without a whole bunch of them. Okay, I actually decided to get started on the redstone network after all, and that needs to connect to all the portals, and I need to set up in such a way where they can send information between themselves and figure out which one needs to be on, which ones need to be off, and... Not that simple of a feat, really. I tried planning this out on paper, like trying to figure out how many wires I was going to need to do all this, even using tricky methods and all that. I figured I'd need at least 3 connecting to all the portals. Turns out I only need 1. thanks to a very awesome little device. And by the way, right now, I've connected the redstone network to the lava bucket. So the idea is, when I select a destination from the panel, it's going to disable all the portals. And then it's going to turn one of them on, the one that we selected. So the network's going to disable all the portals, first of all. So this wire goes to the disable for this portal. And this is the awesome little thing right here. This is a two-way repeater. I saw this on a YouTube channel called Redstone Innovation. And it is the best two-way repeater I've ever seen in Minecraft to date. It is so good. These are 2 sticky pistons. Redstone block. It's a little more expensive than some of them because you got to use redstone blocks, but there's no repeaters. I think it's pretty good, like regarding like lighting updates, and a nice thing about it is it actually carries the length of the signal through it. So let's see. I'm just gonna break this for right now. Actually, you know, we can do a little test here. Let's go up. Let's go back up here. Do 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 do. So the way this works, we'll just turn this on manually. This is not the timer, so it's going to stay on. And as I use my nether portals, I can keep them on too if I want, because this thing's going to be able to disable all of them at once. Oh, don't you shoot at me. And I've also tested these two-way repeaters in creative to make sure that they work in unloaded chunks, and they do. So if we go all the way over here, this is about where another portal's gonna be. Oh, this is like the start of the nether hub right here. Yeah, up here. So, if we send a signal down here, What it does is it pushes, or it makes a sticky piston extend. This goes out, and then when this block comes out, instead of the wire going straight into that block, it connects to this, and that prevents it from looping back and towards itself again, which is what you gotta do when you're making a two-way repeater. But yeah, that goes all the way down. So let's disable that. This will take care of disabling all the portals, but we still need to tell a specific one to turn on. Nice thing about this is we can connect anywhere in the system. Like if we have a portal here, we can connect between two of these repeaters and it will still send the redstone signal to all the portals, no problem. Two-way repeaters would be very nice to have in the game. Like their own block, actually, because they are really cool. So yeah, that disabled the portal all the way from over there. And it would work going from here down that way, too. What was I going to do? I had something else I was going to do. Oh yeah, I got to talk about, so how am I going to enable a specific portal? Well, this carries the length of the signal. So let's say this redstone wire turns on for 10 ticks and then off. With that pulse, we're going to disable the portals, but I'm also going to try invent some kind of decoder that will only let a signal through if, like, for example, this is on for 10 ticks, it'll let a signal through. If it's on 9 or 11 ticks, it won't. And that will be the unique code to turn one of the portals on. And one of them might be for 9 ticks, one for 10, one for 11. So we can send information through the single wire, depending on how long it's on for, to all the portals as well. So that's how we're going to turn a specific one on. We'll give each one its own unique timing. And that makes sending the signal pretty easy too. We just need to send a certain length of pulse to the wire, which isn't really that complicated. And that is the plan. But it's going to take a little bit of time to set it all up, which we won't do all today. But that's what I got in mind. Kind of a fun little technical project that will probably be really useful too. So we have a little bit of a problem here. The map is doing something very strange. It's almost like it's all the colors started to run and now it's a liquid surface on it or something. I think what it's doing actually is it's like rendering the map properly, but now also rendering some layer above it. Yeah, I don't know. And the weird thing is I've tried relogging and it's still doing it. So I might need to completely reload the game or leave the area and come back, and that might fix it. We'll see. But yeah, here is the comment I picked out for today. Thank you everybody for your feedback about the new computer. Lots of great advice was given. And here is some of it. It says, Etho, I would say that as you are a very technical person, that you should not just buy a computer, build one. And before you say it's more expensive or it's too hard, it's not. It's less expensive, and it's straightforward. Ask B-Dubs about it. I'm sure he'll back me up. Also, for $2,000, you could build a very, very, very beastly computer. Much better than anything you can buy with the same amount today. And that kind of goes along with what most people said. As far as I could tell, though, people said the one I was looking at was a good computer, good value, but that I should build a custom one and I would get more for my money. I don't know. I used to always build custom computers in the past, and then one day I was just lazy and I decided I would just buy a store-bought one. And I was very happy with that computer. Then the next one I got was also store-bought. This is going to be my third store-bought one. I've actually been really happy with store-bought computers compared to custom ones. I always had some weird technical problem with the custom ones. Like, I don't know what I don't know what the deal was. Like, stuff would fry every now and then. Of course, it was a long time ago when Windows wasn't as good and that kind of stuff. But you know, I had trouble. The thing is, also, well, actually, I'll say one positive thing about custom computers. Somebody brought out a really good point that when you buy a store-bought one, chances are they're going to put in a really cheap motherboard or the very basic motherboard. That's a really important part of the computer because that's what connects everything together, basically. And you'll want a good quality one, which you probably won't get with a store-bought. And if you build a custom one, you can choose whichever motherboard you want. That almost had me consider building a custom computer, actually. But I decided to go with the one I was looking at. And some of you probably were going to call me a fool for it. But we'll try it. I'm going to try it out. And if I'm unhappy with it, I'll probably do a custom one next time. The thing is, in Canada, I don't think custom computers are much cheaper. I've priced it out. In the past, they actually costed more. I think nowadays it's about even. Maybe a little bit cheaper, but you got to factor in shipping and all that. The main reason, though, is I don't want the stress of of ordering all the parts, making sure they arrive, putting it all together, and making sure I don't fry something. And just the time I save not doing it is definitely good value, because I very much value my time. I don't have a lot of free time. So if I can get out of building a computer, definitely going to go that way. And it just turned out that the computer I was looking at went on sale, $50 cheaper the next day, and free shipping. So I went with it. We're going to get that store-bought one I was talking about, and hopefully it works out. The main thing I'm worried about, actually, is the fan. Since it's from the web, I'm not sure if the fan is quiet on it or not. And if it's loud, it will get picked up in recording, which would really suck. So, we'll see what happens. Anyway, that's going to be it for today, guys. Thank you for watching, as always, and I will see you again next time. Bye-bye.